Christians Engaged. So excited for you to join us today on our third conversation. We're so excited about this new podcast and our new video podcast. And we're really excited today to talk to former Senator Konni Burton, who is the CEO and president of the Texan. We get a lot of questions from Christians around the state about news sources. How do we find good news sources? How do we find out what's really true? All of those questions we're going to be discussing today. So we want you to stick around and hang out with us. Through the month of July, we are offering a special little book I wrote called Enduring to the End, Overcoming Offenses, Bitterness, and Unforgiveness. This is a very important message. So if you donate anything to Christians Engaged through the month of July, we'll send this little booklet, which is about 40 pages, out to bless you. We are excited about giving that away, and it's been a blessing to many people in the political movement already in the state of Texas. So with that, I want to introduce you, my friend, Senator Konni Burton. Konni, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Bunny. It's great to be here with you.
Well, bear with me as I refer to my notes on my iPhone, okay? I'm without paper today. But we're so excited. Tell us a little bit about your background, your political background, and how you got interested in politics, and then what drove you to do what you're doing today.
Okay, terrific. Thank you. So I was this average voter, like so many people out there are today, many years ago, always voted, but didn't really do much more than that. Paid attention to the news on a surface level. I have always been right of center, and it was actually when George W. Bush was in his second term, for me personally, I continued to see government expand to the levels of which I was uncomfortable with it at the federal level. And so that's what got me to be an activist, to kind of look into this more. Why was, the party that was representing me doing the opposite of what they were claiming to do? And so that's what got me involved at an activist level. I just started, reading more, getting involved with organizations that shared my values, went to meetings, those kinds of things, and really learned that there's more to politics than just voting. There's a heck of a lot more to understand legislation that's getting passed, what that legislation means. It was very eye-opening to me. And so I got involved at a very grassroots level and realized that, you can't really take on the federal level so easily, because it's a big behemoth and really to have an impact, you need to start locally or even at the state level. And so that's what I did. I turned to organizations that here in the state of Texas that, again, were like-minded with me and began to realize what I could do to help get legislators that believed in the same values that I did into office, and just absolutely loved that. I mean, just did grassroots, boots on the ground work, knocking on doors, talking to voters, letting them know about what the candidates that I supported believed in and why we should vote for them. And so that's kind of how I got involved at the grassroots level. Then, all of a sudden, I had a state senator who was representing my district who I disagreed with and decided that we needed to have run somebody against her. At the end of the day, it was me that decided to run against her.
I know that. Yes.
Yes. And so anyway, we decided to jump in and run. I had been very involved down at the Capitol, really, not only helping to elect legislators, but going down there and learning issues, learning how legislation was passed, what goes on behind the scenes. So it wasn't like, I just went in totally blind because I wasn't just helping people get elected. I was helping get legislation passed as well. Very involved in the process. So that's why I decided to run for the Senate seat. We won, was down there for 4 years. And then this last election cycle didn't go quite the way we had planned. And so because, I believe so much in the values that I stand for and what I believe in, that wasn't going to deter me. I decided that we were going to move to doing something else that would help Texans to learn and be educated. And my husband and I transitioned to the media world, which is, you know, which may sound bizarre, but it's all very connected, as I'm sure you know, Bunny, and anybody knows, right? I mean, we get our news helps us to know what's happening. And unfortunately, from my perspective, the news these days is nothing but opinion, shrouded as news, right? It's very frustrating to me. It's like, I don't want to hear your opinion, even though you're acting like, you know, this is news. This is really an individual pushing a narrative, or kind of spit their spin on the story. And I've got to tell you, it's all the way from national news right down to the local news. Not all the time, not across the board, not every single article that comes out, but by and large, it is. And I've seen a void in this area. And of course, as an activist, as a senator, you know, and you read the news about yourself and you're like, that's not at all what I said. That's your opinion of what I said, right? And again, talking to so many people throughout the state of Texas that's as frustrated as I am with this, we decided to launch the Texan News.
Well, that brings us to the good point. I mean, many people don't understand that in Texas, they read their local newspapers. Many times those are quoting a statewide news organization like the Texas Tribune, right? That's covering down in Austin. There's very few sources that are covering the Texas legislature and covering the full state. I mean, Texas is huge.
Yes.
So you guys engaging in this process of launching the Texan, tell them a little bit about the Texan and how they find you.
So the URL for the Texan is thetexan.news, actually. And so I encourage everybody to put in the texan.news in their search bar and pull it up. One of the things that I'm so proud of is what we are, again, we, as I mentioned early in this, I am right of center, very committed to those values and principles. And everybody at the Texan is right of center. We admit this. We tell people this. We want people to know what our worldview is. Whereas most of the media, in fact, all of it, says, oh, we're bipartisan. We don't have a, you know, we don't have a worldview. But then you read their articles and you're like, this isn't only a different worldview, this is opinion, right? So we've done it just the opposite of what the media does. We tell everybody, yes, we are right of center. So, you know, we report on the stories that don't get reported so much of the time because these stories don't fit the worldview of those who are left of center. Now it's stories that should, you know, these stories should be important to all Texans. And that's why we get frustrated so much of the time. You know, there are all sorts of stories that don't get covered just because of the worldview itself. So, you know, we tell everybody we're right of center, but our articles that come out are just the who, what, where, when, and why type of articles, right? It gives you the information so that you can be informed and educated. And we reach out to, you know, left of center organizations all the time, the, you know, Democratic elected officials, as well as, you know, say, you know, the Republican Party chair, the Democratic Party chair. We reach out to both. We want those quotes. We want to, you know, people to see where each is coming from. And then the main point that I want to get across to everyone is I want you to make your own decision on that news. You can decide. I mean, you know, there are so many times where people are right of center or left of center can both read an article and say, you know, and they can actually agree on the way forward and how to remedy that situation. Now, sometimes they won't, but what we need to do is leave that up to individuals to decide how they feel about a particular topic instead of always just making people angry about the topic, right? Which is, we can go into more here in a little bit, but yep. Clickbait type of things, right? And that's not what the Texan does.
Well, exactly. Many Christians get upset about headlines. They're you know, we're kind of moved in a direction based on how the news person is taking the story. I mean, it's really frustrating. And many people say, how do we know what's true? How do you as a person, not as the editor of the Texan or the CEO of the Texan, discern based on reading an article what is true? How can people discern that when they see a headline or article, Konni?
Right. I want to go into our business model, not quite yet, but in a minute, Bunny, because I think that's going to help a little bit, believe it or not, on how to, you know, why we've decided to run the Texan the way we have, which I think will give people a lot of comfort in the stories that we put out. But first and foremost, what I, you know, do a lot with any article that I read, click on those links within the article. Don't bypass them. And I used to, and sometimes I still do, frankly, but this is what I found so much of the time is you'll read an article and first and foremost, you know, you're like, okay, is this opinion or is this just giving me the information, right? And you can tell that. Anybody can discern that. So if it's more opinion than just laying out the story for you, I'd be a little, you know, leery of that. But also click on the link within it, because what I have found so much of the time when we're looking through, you know, the news to, you know, to see what stories we should cover, I'll click on that a link within it and I'll read, like, you know, say maybe the original, I don't know, court document, the original ruling, the source themselves. And it's not really, even though it's linked in that main article, it's not what that main article says. So even though they include the link, they've taken the story into a different direction, right? Mm. So I would encourage everybody to start clicking on those links and reading that original source that this, you know, article is taken from and see, did they go down a path that's different than this original, again, ruling or whatever? So that's first and foremost. And if I may, can I talk a little bit about our business model?
Of course, yeah. Because okay. What you guys do, not taking sponsors, is so important.
Right, exactly. So it's kind of important, and I go all over the state talking about the text, and the reason, you know, obviously the media is not doing so well these days, right? I mean, they're laying off people, they're divesting, they're not doing so well. So it's kind of bizarre that my husband and I decided to enter this market. But so we thought a lot about what the problems are with the media and the business model that we wanted to pursue. And one of there's a couple of different things. First and foremost, we are not a nonprofit. And while that may sound, you know, oh, nonprofit, people kind of tend to think, oh, it's a good organization. And not to say that they're not. I'm not saying that at all. Everybody has a different reason to be set up that they are. But when you look at media organizations, particularly there's one in Texas that is a nonprofit, and you start looking at who is funding them, you then start to realize why they have the worldview that they do in all of their articles. I mean, at the end of the day, they're going to want to keep their donors happy, right? And is that the thing that you want to do in a news organization that should just be a very, here's the news, right? There's all sorts of reasons for nonprofits, and I don't begrudge that at all. But in a media organization, that's I think somewhat dangerous. So we're not a nonprofit. The other thing that we decided to do is not have ads anywhere on our site. We do not. That's a main way that most of these media outlets exist, is by having ads. And the problem with that is it's so hard to, you need so much advertising revenue to exist that what happens is you just keep wanting, you know, you want people to click, right? Because you want to sell those clicks to advertisers. Say, please advertise on our site, right? Yeah, they say, please advertise on our site because we have this many clicks. Well, when you start thinking more about clicks than you do the information that you're putting out, again, you get away from, you know, educating and informing, and that is where we get the clickbait headlines. And I don't know if all of your listeners out there have heard of this, but we've all done it. I know I've done it, right? You read a headline and you think, this can't be true, and you click on it, and sure enough, it's not true, right?
Even in our conservative news sources, there's so much of that. Yep. It just gets so old to have to go through it all. all. So
that's right. And there's nobody, it's not just the left or the right, it's both, because they just want, you know, so they put these extraordinary headlines down and they make you click. Well, the information wasn't in it, but that doesn't matter because they've sold another click to another advertiser, right? So that's why we are a subscription-based site. And it's kind of like, which is kind of weird to a lot of people at first. They're like, yeah, wait a minute, I don't want to pay for my news. But if they remember back in the day when it was just newspapers that got tossed on our driveway, you know, we subscribed to the newspaper, right? And the reason that we did that is because the only people we want to be accountable to is not donors, not advertisers, is our readers, right? My husband and I invested a lot of our money to launch this operation. We continue to put in a lot of our money to keep this, you know, to get this operation up and going. And we're young. It's just like any business that anyone starts. And so we sell subscriptions so that people can get our news in their email inbox every morning. And that's that. The only people that we're accountable to is our readers. We give them the information. And if they don't like it, they're not going to subscribe anymore, and we're not going to exist. And so it doesn't matter if some big money donors are there to keep us going, you know, for no other, for just them, right? We're there. We know that our product is what the consumer wants, and they're going to continue to pay us for it. And so that's why we're subscription, because, you know, we don't want anybody else determining the type of content that we should put out other than the readers themselves.
And it's very inexpensive. It's what, like $99 a year or something?
Right. So we you could do it. And there's another thing, you could do it month to month. It's $9 a month. And that way you can just cancel anytime. You can just get it for a month. And then if you don't like it, you can stop. Or if you commit to a year subscription, it's $90 a year, which is what, $7.50 per month, something like that. And we're kind of fun. We're a really fun organization too. We have, promotional items all the time, different ones that we provide if they subscribe for a year. We're very dedicated to Texas history. We love Texas history. So we report on, you know, events that's happened in Texas history. And so we'll usually launch a product with that. So we've, you know, got things from Alamo t-shirts to Texas Independence Day t-shirts to fun things like a pint glass that says the Texan with a famous Texan saying on it. So, you know, we like to promote Texas as well as provide our readers with good, reliable content that just gives them the information so that readers can make up their own mind.
That's great. Well, I was one of your first subscribers.
Thank you.
And I love the stories that come out because there are so many different stories that y'all feature that no one else features. And that's so important. So let's move on to national news sources. Konni Burton, where do you go for your national news? Who do you trust?
Right. So
that's hard.
It is hard. And again, because, you know, I'm right of center, I tend to get my news from those organizations because, again, it's not... Again, their worldview, they talk about the things that are of importance to me, you know, the taxpayer, you know, what things cost, limited government, right? So that's why I trust these particular sites. National Review is a good one. Washington Examiner is another good one. The Federalist. Now, again, even with those, people need to discern whether, because they all have opinion thrown in.
Right.
So discern, is this an opinion piece I'm reading or is this just a news piece that I'm reading? I have the National Review. They send out, you know, alerts, breaking news. And those are really, I really like those because I go, oh, you know, SCOTUS came out with an opinion this morning and they kind of give you an overview. Right. And while I'm talking about that, I want to say really quickly, I'm sorry, when I was talking about our business model, the other thing that we don't do at the Texans, we have no opinion at all. None. We don't even put in op-eds. And there's lots of politicians who ask us, hey, can we put an op-ed in your site? And we say, no. You know, there's plenty of opinion out there with social media and, you know, all the media sites that put in opinion and with most media sites producing opinion that are, you know, disguised as news. We don't do that. So you're not going to see opinion anywhere in our site. It's just going to be news. So anyway, when you are looking at your national sites, make sure whatever they are that you're discerning that it's not opinion. It's just the news. If that's what you're looking for. And I'll tell you what, that's what I'm looking for. I'm tired of being told, you know, how to think, what to think, or to be angry all the time.
Yeah, I remember many years ago, I decided I'm going to turn off the TV and take a sabbatical from all the news, right? So I just, since I worked for a member of Congress, I just signed up for the email alerts from the Hill and, you know, know what I'm getting, but just, hey, I've got to get the facts of what's going on. And, and I encourage people to do that. Take moments where you disconnect from the news for a while.
Absolutely.
Especially in this season that we're in 2020.
Yes.
Because it's important that we not just get overwhelmed sometimes and take a sabbatical from that.
Agreed.
What are, okay, let's talk about, oh, this is a big subject, Konni. Conspiracy theories. Okay, this is hard, but there's so much going on in the world right now that's real. I mean, let's just be honest. There's things that are happening in our world in 2020 that we never saw coming. We're not going to get into details of that. But that, you know, that's true enough that we can share it, right?
Right.
So when you're seeing things on social media, we have a lot of Christians around Texas that share things because they're frustrated. They want to protect their rights. They want to make sure that their family is heard, and they're afraid many times. So how do we discern, okay, this is something good, or how do you do the research to go, okay, this is real. I should share this or not.
Right. Well, and I think something very, very important to know is I think we all want to be the first one out. You know, not only we used to moan about media, you know, trying to be the first one out rather than with accurate information, right? We all used to say that. Now we've all become that.
Oh, that's so true. We all want to be the first of our friends to have that sound bite.
And we're doing what we used to about the media doing. We ourselves are doing it. So first and foremost, just don't hit that, you know, post button, that tweet button, that whatever, just let it play out. Because much of the time, what I see so much of the time is the original narrative that comes out, you come to find later is totally opposite of what you thought, right? And you have egg on your face. As we've seen with many of the media out there these days, a story that looks originally like, and I'm going to bring up a story here. It was the Covington kids. This is something that's very, you know, that we all know. They were immediately accused of doing something. If you don't know, if people don't know, you can look it up. But these Covington kids were accused of doing something, and it went all over. It was viral. And within, you know, 24 hours, when they saw the full video, it was exactly opposite of what these kids got accused of. This has happened on numerous occasions because, again, not only is the media wanting to be out front of a story, individuals are too on social media. And, you know, so people need to stop and let, you know, go to, if there's a longer video version of something, watch the longer version, wait a while to get more information. You know, go to the original source. If somebody's claiming, you know, I don't know, some ruling came out about something, don't immediately share that until you read the ruling, or at least read somebody that you trust and admire that knows that kind of stuff before you do that. I mean, we really need to stop sharing stuff so quickly. That's the first and foremost. And then, of course, you know, like I said, do a little homework. Google it. Google, you know, okay, what's going on here? Let things play out before you share it. That's the main thing.
I agree. I even look to see a lot of articles are written by, you know, nonprofits or by, you know, organizations that have an agenda, right? They want to put out information because they have an agenda to pull you to their website or whatever.
That's right. They're fundraising. Yeah.
Fundraising. Yep. So I always like to go see what they're putting out. And then, yeah, like you said, Google it, find some reliable news sources to back that up. If I think that their article then is worthy of sharing, then I will share it. But I will share it only after I've done significant research to make sure that that is valid, right?
Absolutely.
And it's amazing what you'll find out if you do that. It's just like, there's a movement going on right now that if people had looked at the movement, the about page of the movement, they would know exactly what the movement's about. So We need to do some research, friends.
That's a great example. I totally forgot about that. Any organization, you need to go to the about us before giving them money and look at what the principles are they stand for. What, you know, a phrase can say one thing, but their, you know, actual principles they stand for may be very different than what you believe in.
Right.
Excellent point.
And Christians have a responsibility. I'll get on my soapbox here for a second. To share truth. We're known as the people of truth. We're supposed to speak the truth in love. So we need to make sure that we are carrying the truth. It's our responsibility as individual Christians and Americans to make sure that we're carrying truth, especially now today. So I just encourage everybody with that. Okay, let's go talk about the Texan a little more because I love talking about Texas stories. How do you guys decide what stories you're going to share? That's really hard when you've only got so many resources and so many reporters to pick stories that you think people are going to care about.
Yeah.
How do you make those decisions?
So, you know, first and foremost, again, that's why it's very important that all of us at the Texan are right of center because, again, you know, our worldview is a little different, and there's nothing wrong with that. But we just, you know, we want stories, about how much things cost. What is it going to cost the taxpayer? Many right of center Texans are very concerned about border security. You know, there's a lot of human trafficking as well as drug trafficking. These are things that concern us. And what gets very frustrated is much of the time in other media outlets, we get portrayed as being racist. And it's not about being, it's not racist. It's about being about the rule of law or, the safety and security of Texans. And so that's why, you know, we very much want to get that kind of information out. We want people, our brothers and sisters on the left to understand where we're coming from, not just to be angry deceived, you know, for the reasons that we believe what we believe, right? And so, you know, again, we write stories that, you know, the life issue is obviously very important to us from conception to natural death. And we talk about stories that, you know, involve government overreach in those terms. Again, that should be something that's important to everybody. Now, maybe the remedy for different people who read those articles are different, but it's something that should be, that people should be aware of. So again, if we're writing a story about, you know, about the border, if we're talking about human trafficking, drug trafficking, the rule of law, again, everybody should be concerned about that. And it's not just about, you know, making one section of Texans something that they're not, right? So again, we just want to get those stories out there that we don't all the time. I mean, I'm sure you've heard it, Bunny, and many of us have said, why isn't this getting covered? This is so important. But the only way we see it is, you know, talking to our friends about it, right? That heard about it. So we're getting that information out because it needs to, again, it's something that should be either addressed on a personal level or addressed from a nonprofit level, from the church. You know, should the church get involved and help this community? But if they don't know about it, how are they going to do it, right? Or perhaps maybe there is a legislative remedy to this problem. But again, you know, just because there is a problem doesn't mean everything has a legislative remedy. You know, where, let's get you on your soapbox again, Bunny. Why are we, you know, what is our mission? What is the church's mission? You know, if we cannot do what I believe God wants us to do, if we don't know about the issues that surround us, and if we only talk about them from the perspective that they're a government issue to be resolved, right?
Right.
That's abdicating our role.
And when we're talking about worldview, just so we're clear to people, you know, our worldview is defined by what we believe as the beginning, right? Most of our, when we talk about our worldview as Christians, whether we're Lutheran, non-denominational, Baptist, whatever, our worldview is defined that we believe that there's a creator God that created us all as man and woman, that we have a role to play in this earth. And it also helps us define the role of government because we believe that government is not God. We have
That's
an individual responsibility and personal responsibility for our own lives, and that there's real sin and wickedness in the world.
That's correct.
When you view the world like that, you're automatically going to view the news of the day and the things going on in the culture differently
than humanists or
atheists. And so when we talk about worldview, that's what we're talking about. And then how we define the role of government in our lives is so important. Which leads me to the next question, Konni. We're working all over the state. We're actually just launched our Spanish website this week.
Oh, awesome.
We're going into our first Spanish church in July.
Perfect.
We're talking to people of all ethnicities that are believers, that believe in Jesus Christ, and saying you have a responsibility to pray for your nation, your state, your elected officials. Your voice is important to vote in every election. And you have a responsibility to be educated, some sort of political education and activism, and engage with the culture. As a former legislator and a newswoman now, if Christians actually did that, how do you think that that would change the state of Texas? Because we believe strongly in that mission.
Yes. I think it would change Texas a lot in that, you know, when you begin to vote your morals, your moral values, I think you're going to see a very different Texas, not a different from the beginning of Texas, but a different than you're seeing today, Texas, right? You know, government's role, just as you stated, we get our rights. Our rights are endowed by our creator. That is in our founding documents. That is in the Declaration of Independence, right? We get our rights from our creator. Government's role is simply to protect those rights, not to infringe on them. And so I believe, you know, that tells us that, you know, okay, government's here to protect our rights so that we can go and do our mission that God has given us as individuals and groups, that kind of a thing. And, you know, when you know that you've received your rights from our creator, and that begins at life, and that is one of the values that you believe in, that God has given us life and it must be protected. You need to make sure that who you're voting for also believes in those same values that you do. And don't listen to, you know, sound bites. Don't listen to your friends. Go to that elected officials page and find out about the About Us. Talk to them personally. That's the beautiful thing about focusing on local and state politics. You have much more access to your politicians than you ever will in DC, right? So you can go directly to them and talk to them. Where do you stand on this issue that I believe in because I am a Christian? Ask them specifically, you know, pin them down. And if they don't, and the opponent does believe in the same values you do, then you need to be voting for that elected official. So I think it'll be a beautiful thing if Christians come out and vote their values.
Yes. Okay, one last question. What's your favorite cup of coffee?
So I'm really boring. I don't go to coffee shops. I don't do, you know, any of that. I have my coffee at home. I drink 3 cups of coffee in the morning and I'm ready to go for the day. And believe it or not, we're We're Folgers Colombian. Isn't that horrible?
Wow. Okay. I didn't see that coming. No sugar, probably, or black.
No. That there, you're wrong. I'm sweet and low and a little creamer. You know, it's bizarre. At the Texan, we have all these young kids. They're all so awesome. And, you know, they're all into that coffee stuff and they're particular and everything. And I'm like, just give me my good old fashioned Folgers and I'm happy.
Yes. I'm an instant girl as well. So, well, wonderful. Thank you so much for your time, Konni. We're here with Christians Engaged to engage the body of Christ. We believe there's an awakening going on in 2020 in Texas. And people that are sitting in our pews next to us at church or watching our church services online are being awakened to the fact that we have a responsibility and a biblical mandate to pray, to vote, and to engage in our culture. We're starting a new on-ramp political activism class for Christians that launches July 21st. That'll be 8 hours of intense training, and people can sign up for that for just $25. And we're going to have a great inaugural class to launch them into political activism. So if you're interested in that, look at that on our website. And we are going back in churches as the Lord opens the doors especially in the rural areas are more open than the cities right now. So
right.
Thank you, Senator Burton. You're always Senator to me. Thank you for being my friend and letting me help you when you served in Austin. And it is a blessing for us to serve the conservative movement and the church right now. So thank you so much. And we'll see everybody soon on the next episode of Conversations with Christians Engaged. Blessings.